Hey everybody, this is Erica, the technology nerd who likes to film stuff, and this is the OnePlus 6T. Now, I've had this for a couple of days, and I haven't even had a chance to unbox it, so I'm going to do that for you all now and give some impressions. I've had to move two times this month during this crazy tech October, so that is why this is late. Let's get into it. So right next to us, I have two of my favorite OnePlus 6s to keep us company during this unboxing. Let's see if I can go ahead and get this open. So this is the Midnight Black in 128 gigabytes. And the interesting thing now is that this starts out as 128 gigabytes for internal storage. 64 gigabytes has gone away. Alrighty, let's remove the plastic. Looks like we have a little sleeve here. And finally, there we go. Haha! So lifting it quickly out of the box, you can see that it looks very similar already to the OnePlus 6. We just don't have that fingerprint sensor there at the back. It's now inbuilt into the display as an optical fingerprint sensor. Very curious to try that out. Haven't gotten to try one yet. Have heard mixed reviews so far, and that it's not the fastest and sometimes not the most accurate, but no matter. So it tells you right here, to maximize the performance of our in-display fingerprint sensor, we recommend using screen protectors from OnePlus and our official partners. So if you use an unofficial accessory, you might have some trouble with getting your finger to be recognized. I don't really care though, because I hate screen protectors. Let's get this off. Now this has Gorilla Glass 6 on it. I'm not sure if the back has Gorilla Glass 6, but definitely the front, so that should be super durable. But realize that glass is glass and it's going to scratch at about a 6 on Mohs scale, so we're talking more about damage and cracking and not as much scratches. But anyway, let's set this aside momentarily, see what else is in the box. So we should have a case in here and some other documentation. So it looks like we've got a black clear TPU case, and we've got a SIM ejection tool and some other documentation. Then we've got the dash charging brick and the cable. And at the very bottom of the box, we've got a little dongle for headphones. And as far as headphones go, they did provide me with these bullet headphones. So these are USB Type-C bullet headphones, and they're USB Type-C as we no longer have a headphone jack. All right, let's turn the phone on. So we'll let this boot up. There we are. Now looking at it size-wise compared to the OnePlus 6 right here, it looks like it's ever so slightly larger. So it's not too cumbersome still of a size. It's got a 6.4 inch display. This is getting nuts with these displays. They're just so big now. Truly, I can't complain because I do like big displays on phones. And here is the red version. So I'm wondering when they're gonna come out with a red one, but at first draw, it looks like we've got the midnight black and the mirror black finish. All right, so this phone is now all set up and it's actually been a few days later and I've been using this for a couple of days and I have been really impressed with the OnePlus 6T, really loving what I've experienced so far. So let's start off with the fingerprint sensor. It's an optical in-screen fingerprint sensor. And so all you have to do is make sure the screen is on, and it gives you this little area right here where you can see the fingerprint. This is where you're supposed to place your finger. It lights up very brightly, and bada bing, bada boom, there you go. So in practice, it's actually been very accurate for me, and I think a lot of that is going to have to do with how you enrolled your fingerprint. I made sure to enroll my fingerprint at an angle, just like I would usually when I unlock my phone. I always unlock it like this. And so it's been accurate every single time. So I've been hearing people complain about the accuracy. No issue whatsoever. It's great either way. If I use my right or left hand, no problem whatsoever. So really mash your finger in there, work it around at an angle, and it works just fine. And it's not the fastest fingerprint sensor in the world, but really it's very quick. I have no complaints whatsoever, and I'm really liking it, honestly. The small gripe that I do have with using this in-screen fingerprint sensor is that the display does have to be on in order for it to work. So the display is off right now, nothing's happening. So you have to tap the screen, make sure that it's on, then you can see that it works. The best thing that you can do to get this to go more smoothly with the fingerprint reader is where you see it says when to show, make sure pick up your phone to show is selected, and tap the screen to show. Now the next thing that struck me is the calibration of this display and all the modes that we have. So we've got the default mode, the sRGB mode. This is going to be your color accurate mode for sRGB content, which is consumer content. Everything you see on the Android operating system, everything that you see online, it's all sRGB encoded. So it makes sense to use the sRGB mode. Unless you have wide gamut content that uses DCI-P3, then you would select the DCI-P3 mode and the colors will represent properly. You've got an adaptive mode, which really changes the color temperature depending on the ambient lighting situation. That is what I've seen. And then you've got custom color, so you can change the white point of your display to your heart's content. So I went and I measured the sRGB mode, and it's very accurately calibrated on most things. I was actually pleasantly surprised. So it's got a good white point. It's a nice neutral D65 white. Whites look like they should. It's got pretty good color coordinates, so all the saturations look like they are where they should be. The one thing that I notice is that the gamma is a little bit high. It's almost 2.5. It should be 2.2, so the colors look just a little bit more contrasty or darker than they should. So when you have high gamma, it not only dims the colors, but it saturates them as well. So I noticed that things just look just a tiny bit off in that way. But otherwise, good job. And then we come to talking about this notch. Now, when the screen is off and before I set it up, I actually liked the way that this notch looked. It kind of looked a little bit pretty, a bit cute, a bit jewel-like. But honestly, now that I've started it up and used it, it's a little bit strange because these curves are so pronounced. Dare I call it voluptuous in a way. So most of the time, I prefer to go underneath notch display and hide it. So what that's going to do for you is make the active screen area look like a normal screen, but you've got some notifications up here in that notch area. So I think that's a good compromise. Now the other little complaint that I have about this notch, well actually it's the shape of the screen on the sides here, is that it both trims and rounds the corners a little bit of your content. So it's kind of eating some of that content off like you snipped it off with scissors. I find that it looks a little bit odd, especially because the OnePlus 6 before it, you can see that it was nice and straight and up and down. There's no trimming of the corner there. So they've done some interesting things with rounding the look of the display. It's a tiny complaint, but it's something I notice. So now let's talk about the interface or the user experience. This phone is really nice and smooth. Always OnePlus has done such a great job at making such a nice and smooth interface experience, and it just makes you want to use this phone. There's no lagginess at all that I can see. And plus, there's all kinds of customizations that really bring out that user experience as well. Starting off looking at buttons and gestures, we have the first option, which is alert slider. So you can customize your alert settings manually on the side of the phone right here. This switch, this slider is still here. I'm so glad that they've kept this. So you've got the option for silent, vibrate, and then ring. And it's just so easy to access. You don't really even have to think about it. And then I really love what they've done with the navigation bar and gestures. So this is where I just felt kind of like smacking Google in the face because OnePlus has done it right. So on the Pixel 3 XL, I've just not been liking the navigation. So starting right here, you can see that this says back and home. This is how Google should have done it. So let's go ahead and go to the home screen. Now on Google's Pixel 3 XL, when you go upward once, it brings you into your recents. And then if you go upward again, it brings you into your application tray. That's annoying to have to do a double swipe to get into the applications. Now with this, if you pull upward, there are your applications, just a little bit above where we have this little home button here. If you pull it up right here, brings you into your recents. Pull it up right here, brings it into your app tray. It's very simple and very intuitive, but it still keeps some of the Google launcher features, such as once you pull upward, of course, you can go to your different recents, and then you can go along the bottom and swipe between your recents as well. It's just a better implementation. You access split screen the same way that you would on the Pixel as well. So there you are. But then just say you don't really like this particular navigation option, you can choose something else. Just say that you like the standard way of how things used to be of old. So go ahead and just select that. back home in recents. And you've got your little navigation button bar down here at the bottom. And then they've got navigation gestures, which I think work pretty well, but I don't prefer to use. I prefer using the middle one that I showed you before that looks kind of like what the Pixel has. So when you swipe upward, it brings you into your recents. You just have to pause for a moment there. Or you can do an iPhone-esque type thing, going upward from the middle and swiping to the side. And this lets you switch between two recent applications. And if you want to go back, you can either go up from the left or the right, and it's going to go backward. And again, activating split screen is the same way. So you have all those different options to pick and choose what suits you best, and I really appreciate that. We've also got a plethora of quick gestures, so you can flip to mute, you can use three fingers to take a screenshot, put the phone up to your ear and answer a call. They just give you so many different options. Now on the size of this phone, they have not added a dedicated button to get to any type of assistant, but what they've done here is you can quick activate the assistant app. So once this is selected, all you have to do is hold down on your power button and it brings you into the Google Assistant. So if you hold down on the power button for 5 seconds, it brings up the Google Assistant. And if you hold it down a bit longer, it's going to bring up the power off. So that's really nice and easy. You can see I hold it just a little bit longer and there's power off. It's just little things like that that's just so simple, but didn't require adding something else to deface the phone. So the user experience here is absolutely second to none. I can completely recommend anybody getting this phone for this very reason. But what else do you get for the money? And we'll talk about the pricing in a little bit, which is excellent, by the way, compared to everything else you can get in the flagship realm. So you also get fast charging with a dash charger, and that's always excellent. What's really awesome is you plug it in and you can keep using your phone with the display on, and the charging speed does not slow down. We've got a bigger battery this time around. For a while, they've stuck to 3,300 milliamp hours. This is now 3,700 milliamp hour battery inside of this guy. And with a 3,700 milliamp hour battery and a 1080p display, you bet that this lasts a nice long time. I don't have any exact numbers yet, but this is going to get you very easily through the day. I also think OnePlus makes particularly attractive looking phones, and this one feels really great in the hand. Now, of course, I'm sure they're going to come out with other colors, and I'm hoping for this really nice red one. And now that we don't have this fingerprint sensor on the back, that's one less blemish to take away from the beauty of the back of the phone. Now, we've got this matte metal-like appearance to this, same as we did on the OnePlus 6. You can turn it, and you can see it kind of makes a little bit of an S. Now, unlike the blunder of what Google did with the Pixel 3 and the Pixel 3 XL, is it's not abrasive. So your keys aren't scratching against it and leaving residue from the keys. You're not scratching up surfaces. So you get this nice matte look that really reminds you of metal, but none of the downsides. And we've also got some decent cameras on this guy. Now the hardware is the same that we have on the OnePlus 6, but they have a couple of optimizations algorithm-wise. They've added a couple of new modes, such as the nightscape mode, and also a studio lighting feature that's activated automatically on portraits. For the price range of this phone, I was already really quite happy with the photos on the OnePlus 6. I thought that the colors were great, I liked the dynamic range. So we're expecting the same thing here, with just a couple of other little features. And we'll have to see how useful that nightscape setting actually is. If you want a phone, though, that's really great in low light, that's where you're going to have to boost your price range. But otherwise, I felt just fine using the OnePlus 6 as my daily driver for a camera. I felt like I could trust it just fine. Another cool thing is that you're going to be able to buy this from T-Mobile stores, so this is easily accessible to people in the United States now. You don't have to buy it off Amazon or OnePlus's website. So this instills a lot of confidence for me in this phone. And it's also really nice that we finally have support for those who are on Verizon. That was kind of a stitch in the side of those who are on Verizon that they've not been able to use the OnePlus line. So that is a problem no more. So with all of these great things that this phone has to offer, what doesn't it have? Well, we don't get those stereo speakers. The receiver here does not double as a second speaker to accompany the one that we have on the bottom. Now, the bottom speaker that we have right here is pretty loud. I like it. I don't have a lot of trouble with it. The only thing, though, is that, of course, when you're holding your phone like this, watching media, you're always blocking that speaker. And that's where I do value having the receiver acting as a double speaker. We also don't have wireless inductive charging. Now, if it came to wireless charging versus being able to plug it in and have it charge up really quickly, I would definitely choose the Dash Charge anytime. We don't have a true IP rating, although you can splash it and get it a little bit wet. That one is a bigger stitch in my side for me because I live in the rainy Pacific Northwest, and it's important that my devices are pretty much as waterproof as they can be. Some might be bummed that this is not a quad HD display, but it looks really beautiful just as it is. They've done a pretty darn good job with calibrating it. As long as an OLED display is at least 1080p, I don't really have much complaints. So my thought is probably the biggest complaint that people are going to have is about the cameras and more or less in low lighting. But otherwise, there really isn't much to complain about here. You get the Snapdragon 845 SoC, you get 6 or 8 gigabytes of RAM, and the configuration is now starting at 128 gigabytes of internal storage for $549. So it's 6 gigabytes of RAM and 128 gigabytes for $549. If you get the 8 gigabytes and 128 gigabyte configuration, it's $579. And then if you jump up to the 8 gigabyte and 256 gigabyte storage option, it's $629. So topping out at $629 is still much less expensive than going over the $1,000 mark. They've really done something quite profound here. And on top of all these great specs, they have committed to an update schedule so we don't have to worry about these getting left behind in the dust like some other Android phones. You're going to get operating system updates. You're going to get security updates. You can buy this at T-Mobile and you can use it on Verizon. So that's pretty great, all for maxing out at $629. So I can't wait to continue using this and especially using the camera and checking out some of the camera improvements. So this has been Erica, the technology nerd who likes to film stuff. Please rate, comment, and subscribe, and stay tuned for the full review. Make sure to leave all your comments that you'd like down in the comment section below so I know what to cover. It's very similar to the OnePlus 6, so there's really not all that much. I'll check to see if there are any significant differences, but otherwise you've got a new fingerprint sensor in this guy, a bigger battery, a couple of optimizations, really. And as it is, the Nightscape feature is going to be on the OnePlus 6 after an update as well. So pick whichever one works for you. Again, let me know what you guys think and have a good night.